Welcome into the Thursday episode of the David Hookstead Show. Happy to have you all here as always. I'm going to be straightforward with you. We have some fireworks today. Usually I don't come out that strong and say that at the beginning of an episode, but we do. Why do we have fireworks today? Well, as many of you know, I'm sure most of you watching this know, Kyle Rittenhouse took the stand yesterday in his own defense trial after being accused of multiple homicide charges. You know, I think the evidence is quite clear. He acted in self-defense. The case has been an absolute, the trial, I mean, has been an absolute shit show for the prosecution. It's nothing more than a circus at this point. It's quite frankly really disgraceful. But you know who is not impressed with Kyle Rittenhouse on the stand? LeBron James. Yeah, for some reason, LeBron James, who gets paid money to shoot a basketball and win basketball games, now thinks he's an expert on what people, on how people will behave on the stand when reliving past trauma. I'm going to read you a tweet here from LeBron James. This is word for word. In response to a USA Today tweet that says, Kyle Rittenhouse broke down in tears at his murder trial while on the witness stand as he described the events of August 25th, 2020 in Kenosha, Wisconsin. Now, as you all know, Rittenhouse shot and killed two people who were attacking him, Rosenbaum, and I believe the other guy's name, last name is Huber, and then he shot the guy with the pistol and blew his bicep apart, or his lower bicep apart, and obviously the rest is history. He's been charged with the two killings, he's been charged with the other shooting. It's an absolute embarrassment, and you would think, oh, there's this poor 18-year-old on the stand crying. He's clearly reliving a PTSD-esque moment. He's reliving severe trauma. You know, you'd have a lot of empathy for him. Everyone I talked to yesterday had a lot of empathy when Rittenhouse broke down on the stand. You got to remember, he was 17 years old when he was left with no choice but to shoot and kill people who were attacking him. LeBron James, this was his response. What tears? Question mark, question mark, question mark, question mark, question mark. I don't see one. Man, knock it off. That boy ate some lemon heads before walking into court. This is why LeBron James might be the dumbest person actively playing sports. Colin Kaepernick's probably the dumbest person in all of sports, but he's not playing in a while. LeBron James, this tweet, there is no defense for this tweet whatsoever. There is simply not. It is such a disgusting thing for a human to say about another human. Here we have this young, essentially a child. Now, he's 18 now. He's legally adult, but let's not make a mistake. He is a child. He is a kid, but for all intents and purposes, he is a kid who had to do the unthinkable because he thought he was going to die. Those are his words. Kyle Rittenhouse got on the stand and said if he didn't shoot Rosenbaum, Rosenbaum would take his gun and use it against him. So he did what he thought he had to do as Rosenbaum tried to get his gun away from him. It is a horrific situation to put a 17-year-old in. And then to have that 17, now 18-year-old, get on the stand and relive the worst 10-minute span of his life as he breaks down in tears, and to think he's faking it, to think he is faking it is so disgusting's not the right word because it goes beyond that. That just lacks humanity. LeBron James lacks basic humanity if he saw what we all saw and thought that kid was faking. That looked like a young man who was in a night terror. Now, as I tweeted yesterday, I've been fortunate enough to not really have had to have lived a life to have seen many people who've dealt with severe trauma issues, but I have seen some. And what I will tell you, as I said yesterday, it mirrors that. It mirrors his behavior on the stand when he broke down. It is night terror-esque. If you've ever seen someone who's having a night terror, it's way different than a nightmare, as we all know. It's sheer and utter panic. You see it in young kids. His look on his face yesterday as he broke down was sheer and utter panic and fear. That's what that was. And for LeBron James to get up there on Twitter to, I think he has about 50 million followers, and claim that he was faking it and that he ate lemon heads before getting on the stand is so gross and so irresponsible and so disgusting and lacks basic human empathy that, quite frankly, it is maybe the worst thing I've ever seen LeBron James do. And I remember, LeBron James doxed that heroic police officer in Ohio who shot and killed that young woman who was in the process of trying to stab someone. So this is a pattern for him. This is not new. It's not new at all. And I don't know how anyone could watch the Rittenhouse case and think even close to what LeBron James says. And look, I don't know Kyle Rittenhouse. Maybe we'll have him on the David Hookstead show after this is all over, after he gets acquitted and walks out of the courtroom. Because make no mistake, folks, that's where this is headed. I've watched almost the entire trial. I've watched every bit that the prosecution did. I've watched most of what the defense has done. I've watched a large part, almost all of Rittenhouse's testimony. The prosecution comes off like a bully and nothing more. He comes off like a man bullying a young child who is scared. It's beyond the pale. It is a mockery of our justice system. This whole trial is a sham. It is a show trial for, quite frankly, nothing more than political purposes. The judge knows it. The defense knows it. The American public knows it. And for LeBron James then to get on Twitter and tweet what he said is so horrific that LeBron James, if his sponsors had any pride whatsoever, if his friends had any pride whatsoever, if his agent had any pride whatsoever, they would sit LeBron James down and tell him to shut the fuck up. Because he doesn't know what he's talking about. He has no idea what he's talking about. Let's not forget, LeBron James will kiss the shoes of the Chinese dictatorship. Do I need to tell LeBron what they do in China? Okay? If you protest in China, you just disappear. You go against the Chinese government. You burn cities down in China, you get lined up a wall and get shot. China is a modern day Nazi Germany. China has modern day concentration camps. China tramples on the human rights of ethnic minorities in their country. There is no freedom over there. They kill people who disagree with the communist regime, who disagree with the dictatorship. Kyle Rittenhouse was a scared 17-year-old who was attacked and shot and killed two people and a third who survived because, in his words, he felt he had no other choice. Whose side is LeBron James on here? The communist dictatorship of China, which has killed more people probably on a daily basis than Kyle Rittenhouse did in Kenosha, Wisconsin, or on the side of Kyle Rittenhouse, who all the evidence points to has did what he did in self-defense. Well, of course, that jackass moron is siding with the... He won't say shit about China, but he will trash Kyle Rittenhouse. And to me, that tells you all you need to know. LeBron James is a coward. LeBron James is a moron. LeBron James has no idea what the fuck he's talking about. LeBron James is going to smear a man, an 18-year-old young man, who's about to be acquitted on charges that never should have been brought against him. This whole trial is a joke. It is an embarrassment to the American justice system. Everything we were taught growing up about fairness, about the truth mattering, has meant nothing in this trial so far. Now, I hope the jury has seen through this whole charade and brings us back the verdict we all know Rittenhouse deserves, which is acquittal on all counts. I hope that's what the jury does. But LeBron James, for him to send that tweet to his 50 million plus followers, what if one of his followers sees that tweet and thinks, you know what? We didn't get justice. I'll just go take Rittenhouse out myself. I'll just do what the courts did because LeBron James told me he's faking it. Is LeBron James going to accept responsibility for those actions? Because remember, the new climate we live in is if you say something, one of your followers does something stupid or one of your fans does something stupid, you're responsible. LeBron James has 50 million followers. I believe on just Twitter alone. That doesn't even include Instagram. If one of his followers does something to Rittenhouse or Rittenhouse's family because of that tweet, should LeBron James be held liable? That's a very interesting conversation. It's a conversation I'd be very interested to hear both sides of. I think LeBron James should, quite frankly, not just apologize. He should probably delete his social media. And he should look Rittenhouse in the eyes for that tweet and say he's sorry, accept responsibility. It is beyond disgusting. It is horrific. And LeBron James should be ashamed of himself. And I'm getting angry just sitting here talking about it. Rittenhouse, as far as the evidence tells me, didn't do a goddamn thing wrong. And the bodies that he dropped that night in Kenosha, in my opinion, based off the evidence we have seen, was the definition of self-defense. And the fact the prosecution even thought that this was an acceptable thing to do in the United States of America with all the video evidence we have is beyond words, and everyone involved in it should be embarrassed and ashamed, including LeBron James. And that's all I'm going to say about that. Next, Georgia football star Adam Anderson has been arrested on a rape charge. He's been accused of rape. He's been charged. He voluntarily turned himself in on Wednesday to the Athens County Police Department, I believe, or the county jail, whatever it might be. He's facing a count of rape. What he's accused of doing, now I got to remember, it's all alleged. He's innocent, he's presumed innocent until proven guilty. That's the system we have here in America, which ties in nicely with the Rittenhouse thing. He is presumed innocent until proven guilty, but what he's been accused of doing is, a couple Friday nights ago, I believe it might have been before the Florida game or right after the Florida game. You can read about it on dailycaller.com. The details are there. He's accused of a woman waking up after they had some drinks together. She woke up to him raping her. It's an allegation. That's the accusation in front of him. That's what he's been charged with. He's already been suspended indefinitely, so he's not playing for the Bulldogs right now. My guess is that he does not play for the Bulldogs again as long as this is going on. Obviously, they're not going to put a guy on the field facing the charges he is facing, right? You're not going to put a guy on the field with a rape charge hanging over his head. That's a PR nightmare. But here's what I'll say to this. We have a justice system in this country, right? A justice system that has seemingly ignored Rittenhouse, that has failed Rittenhouse, that has ignored the evidence in that case. What we need to do here is not rush to judgment on anything. His attorney has denied the allegations. I think in any situation like this, the smart stance to take is always, look, it's a serious allegation. It's a serious accusation. It's going to be investigated. He's been charged. We're not going to rush to convict this guy, unlike the media did to Rittenhouse. We're not going to rush to convict this guy, but we need to find out what happened. We need to hear the facts, and we'll get to the bottom of it. But look, Anderson is not going to be playing football for the rest of the season because this ain't going to be finished for a very long time. And Kirby Smart is not putting any kid out on the field facing a rape charge. That just ain't going to happen. So let me know what you think of the Georgia rape case allegations. I'll be very curious to hear it. I think it's obviously a very tragic, very serious situation. All right. This is a bit of a more bad news. I hate to be always on the bad news train, but we have a lot of unfortunate news. All right. Minnesota Vikings offensive lineman Dakota Dozier, maybe is how you pronounce it. I don't know. If he's watching, I apologize. I'm sure he's a big fan of the show. He had to be hospitalized. Now, he's fully vaccinated, but he had to be hospitalized for breathing issues after contracting COVID-19. Now, you got to remember, he's a bigger guy. He's an offensive lineman, so you know he's a heftier big. We all know offensive linemen are big dudes. First and foremost, we're all hoping he gets well. We're all hoping he gets out of the hospital. We all want to see him get well. No one wants to see him, you know, be in the hospital, getting sick, anything like that. That's terrible. We're hoping he gets well. But number two, this is a reminder that this whole situation isn't over yet. And the vaccine, while effective and safe, and I believe in it, is not a catch-all vaccine, right? He was fully vaccinated. He got COVID-19, had to be hospitalized because of breathing issues. So just remember, folks, there's a lot of ways to protect yourself from COVID-19. I got vaccinated. Another great way to protect yourself is be in good shape. Make sure your health issues are in check. Don't be a ton overweight. And I'm not saying he's out of shape. He's an NFL player. They're bigger guys, but they are in shape, right? Your average offensive lineman, while probably on a BMI scale is considered obese, he's still in way better shape than your average American. It's just an unfortunate situation. I hope he's out of the hospital soon. I don't want anyone to get COVID-19. I don't want anyone to be hospitalized. I would encourage you all to consult with your doctor for what you think is best. If you want to get the vaccine, I encourage you to go get the vaccine. I don't think there's anything wrong with it. Like I said, I've been vaccinated, so it doesn't bother me at all. All right, Carson Wentz will not skip the game this Sunday against the Jaguars for the birth of his child if the child is born during the game. And a lot of people are kind of, you know, ragging on him for this a little bit. But look, we actually had a debate in the Daily Caller offices a few years ago about if you were playing in the Super Bowl and your wife was going to give birth during the Super Bowl, would you leave or would you stay and play the game? And I said, you have to stay and play the game. You could never go back to the Super Bowl again the rest of your career. You can always have more kids, you know, and especially if it's not your first child being born. Look, the Super Bowl is the Super Bowl. We've only had, what, 53 of them, 54 of them? Okay, you can pop out another kid anytime. But the Super Bowl is the Super Bowl. You got to stick and play. And most of the office agreed with me when I said that. Some people in the office were like, if my husband didn't skip the Super Bowl, I would break up with him. I'm like, oh, wow. Who gives? What are you going to do? You're going to break up with your NFL superstar husband, and it's not like he just won't find a new woman like that? We're talking, because in the scenario, he's the starting quarterback, much like Wentz is in this case. Look, I love the idea of relationships and love and all that stuff and families, yada, yada, yada. Every disclaimer I have to say here so people don't get pissed. Look, you're getting paid millions of dollars. You want to be rich or you want to be at the hospital? You want $2 million extra dollars in your bank account, whatever your game check might be? Or do you want to be at the hospital where everything's going to be totally fine and your team loses? What do you want? You want $2 million, $1 million, $500,000, whatever you might be making on the season or per game? Or do you want to be at the hospital? I'd be playing at the Super Bowl, slinging passes left and right so fast, and I'd have someone there giving me updates. You know, we're going to have some updates rolling in. I'm not skipping the Super Bowl for someone's birth. I don't care if it's my firstborn, secondborn, 18th born. It is the Super Bowl. And if I win the Super Bowl, I'm going to make a lot more money on my next contract that's going to set up my family for, you know, generations to come. And that was the point I tried to make during that debate. And people just didn't, most people agree with me, some people just didn't seem to get it. But it is 100% the correct take. Do not skip the Super Bowl. Do not skip the game. You got to focus on the long term. Got to focus on the future. And that money from that game will do a lot more for your family than you simply being there holding your wife's hand. I think that should be obvious, but apparently it is not. Only Murders in the Building. I just finished it Wednesday night with my girlfriend. She'd seen it previously. She got me into it. I loved it. You got Steve Martin, Martin Short, Selena Gomez. The plot is essentially they have this podcast solving the death of a person who lives in their apartment building by the name of Tim Kono. And it has a bunch of twist endings, a lot of curveballs thrown at you. I really liked it. If you're looking for a good mystery series, I would recommend watching Only Murders in the Building. There's a great cliffhanger. Now, there's a big twist ending, and then you have a cliffhanger. The cliffhanger is actually better than the twist ending. The twist ending, while not bad, is, you know, a little out there. That's what I'll say. I'm not going to ruin it for you. But the cliffhanger is better than the twist ending. Finally, the season 15 trailer is out for It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia. And it looks incredible. It looks like they're going to cover the Capitol riot on January 6th. Frank is going to be an associate of Jeffrey Epstein, apparently, and he was going to be on the island of Epstein on his plane. I encourage you all, you can watch the trailer at dailycaller.com. It looks phenomenal. Anyways, that's all we have for the Thursday episode of the David Hookstead Show. Make sure to check back Saturday for our Week 11 college football special. I'll see you all then.